installation by Corey Arunachai in collaboration with Alex Grodich. You only see one screen here. It's actually a three-screen installation with a laser element, a sculptural element. It's a very powerful soundtrack of words, but also music. And it's a work that deals with issues around care, family, superstition, religion, nationhood, myth-making. Very powerful work. On the other screens, you will see his very old grandparents, one of whom has dementia, and they're very much talking about issues around how you care for people, how you prepare to die. And the center screen is a narrative that's questioning the reality of what happened in the summer of 2018, where you'll remember there was a very well-publicized incident with 13 school children who were trapped in a cave in Thailand, and became a great media drama as the military was finally able to rescue them. And the artist uses that as the way to talk also about how a government looks after its people, but how it also creates myths about itself. It turns out none of the children were actually Thai, but the government claimed them all as Thai school children to create this myth. I said some of the works will explore this idea that other worlds, parallel worlds. This is a diorama by Dominique Gonzalez-Foster and Joy Bittel that shows you a Martian landscape. And it's inspired by Dominique's interest in a science fiction book by Ray Bradbury of Martian Chronicles. But I think the idea of Mars is back in the news because there's interest suddenly in seeing if we can colonize Mars and inhabit it, which seems like an idea that could only be fueled by people really thinking that Earth has a limited future. And I think this strange sense of, an image that you see when you see this, which could be an image of an Earth after an apocalypse, or it could be an image of a future Mars. At the same time, a number of works in the exhibition, including Dominique's other work in the exhibition, which is a virtual reality piece, deal with the impact of new technologies in creating a sense that we live in a different world. And I think the diorama, historically, is really one of the earliest virtual reality technologies. By the use of this window, the space on the other side becomes like an image. It's a virtual space. And you enter imaginatively. This is also a diorama type installation made of these very beautiful curvy aluminium forms by the Chinese artist Lu Wei. Instead of evoking the macro world of Mars, this is invoking the invisible micro world of subatomic particles. And again, that's the idea that, yes, there's more than one world that we're living in. Don't always have access to these other worlds. This is a Jordanian artist, Lawrence Abu Hamdan, who's made an incredible 20-minute video in which he appears in the broadcasting booths of the former state radio in East Germany. This was their headquarters in Berlin. And he accounts a number of legal cases in which sound was used as evidence. He's very interested in the idea that because of technologies for surveillance that the police and the military have developed, none of us really, there's no protection anymore for walls. There's equipment that can hear through any wall and that can gather evidence and invade your privacy. He also talks about, in this film, a notorious prison in Syria, where the sounds of other prisoners being tortured was something that was used deliberately to disturb all the prisoners who were kept there, and that they would listen through the walls themselves. It's a very interesting piece about, it's called Walled Unwalled. It's this idea of the way boundaries are constantly changing. Here's another wall. This is not the kind of Trump wall Donald Trump wants to build. But this is a wall that comes from Mexico, from the city of Juarez. It's been reframed as a sculpture by the artist Teresa Margolis. It was a wall in front of a school where a number of young people were assassinated in drug-related violence. And in Mexico, in this 10-year period from 2006 to 2015, over 15,000 teenagers were killed in drug-related violence. There are a number of artists in the exhibition who make photographic self-portraits. This is Amelia O'Malley from South Africa, who's really quickly established herself as one of the most interesting photographers of her generation. Her work definitely is challenging a lot of stereotypes around black female identity, around lesbian identity, around African identity. She often stares out at the viewer in ways that you feel might be confrontational or might be asserting her own sense of self, depending on who you are. I mean, she's definitely aware that different people will look at her images in different ways, and she plays with that. Another artist who's taking pictures of herself is this Japanese artist, Mary Katayama, who was born with a congenital illness that meant she had to partially amputate her legs when she was 9, and she was born with this claw-like hand. And she uses her own body as a sculpture for talking about ways in which women's bodies are socially and culturally described, and for asserting against that her own physical experience of herself, and creating a sense of playing with, I think, conventional ideas of desire and seduction, but I think very powerfully changing the way we look at a body that's gone through the kind of amputation that she's gone through. And then you'll see, when you see the other photographs in this exhibition, that they really completely change the way you look at someone with a different type of body. This is a still from a video image by Alex de Corte, an artist who was born in Venezuela but lives in the United States. It's one of 57 videos that he will be showing in the Arsenal in an installation setting where you sit on very large furniture and feel very small. And it's kind of an inventory of fictional characters from the 20th and 21st century, from Bart Simpson to Daffy Duck to ketchup bottles, consumer goods. And it's a very antic. He plays every character in these 57 videos. It's a real tour de force. This is a painting by a Nigerian-born artist, Njideka Akinwumi Crosby, who emigrated to the United States when she was 18. And many of her pictures include images of her family members, including her husband, who's a white American man. And she, a lot of her work is about having this sense of feeling outside of the culture she's living in. And she's developed an interesting technique of inserting collages into these interior scenes that she depicts with large blocks of solid color, and including many, many images that are personal images, news images that give keeps breaking into intimate domestic space. One of the key things that I hope this exhibition gets across is the idea that the best art straddles categories. The best art exists in between the categories that we already have. And it does this not simply because artists don't want you to be able to pigeonhole their art, but because by sitting in between categories, it also can raise questions about those categories. If they can't accommodate and account for this kind of art, it begins to suggest that there are limitations to those categories. And these, of course, are the categories we use to shape and order our picture and understanding of the world. So when you start to have those categories dissolve, you begin to have to form a new way of looking at the world. So these paintings by Julie Nuretu mix the language of abstract painting with work that's about reference to the world we live in. And she's actually begun this series of paintings by using blurry photographs, documentary photographs of current events, including demonstrations, marches, large fires, protests, and then creating over them an overlay of different types of mark making that create this restless, pulsating feeling of energy that feels very unsettled. And within it, you will notice at times traces of the original image. And that sense of marrying abstract painting, which traditionally was considered something that was supposed to transcend the banality of everyday reference, with our fact that we are living, that we can't escape the world we live in. There is no transcendence. But she makes something by creating a work that exists in between these categories of abstraction and reference.